What I was going to do today is kind of like delve into some weirder, kind of off the beaten path topics. One not so weird that is very classic, like optimal control that we just didn't do is kind of like calculus of variation stuff, which I avoided for most of the class. So we'll do a little bit of that just to kind of connect the dots to like how like this stuff all connects to physics and like what all this like Lagrangian Hamiltonian stuff is, which the punchline is it's all basically all trajectory optimization. And just like weird mashup ways. And the cool hook here is like for robotic stuff is that this kind of viewpoint is really useful for doing things with contact interactions. So any like non-smooth dynamics kind of stuff, we have impacts and friction, which is like super pervasive in robotics. There's like a really natural kind of viewpoint on that stuff and how to set it up and both simulate it and do control with it. It also nicely ties into like the stuff we talked about last time with like Nash equilibrium and dynamic games. It turns out these are connected as well. So I don't know, kind of interesting. All right, so let's get into it if anybody has any other questions. By the way, yeah, I think we confirmed it's going to be posters, not talks, right? Everyone's good on that front. And it's the last two classes we're going to do poster session stuff. And stay tuned on Piazza for some announcements about that. We don't have class this Thursday also, right, for Carnival. So cool. So this is it for this week. And then next week, I'm again open to suggestions if anyone wants specific topics, but otherwise I might make at least one of the lectures next week, like basically just more project consulting hours for everybody. And if you have like requests for like a lecture topic, I'm open to such things. Okay, cool. So last time we did driving. And we talked about dynamic games, which are kind of a fun twist on this optimal control setup where you have like multiple agents and interacting in potentially adversarial, non-cooperative ways. That shows up in all kinds of interesting contexts, driving being one. And we're actually going to kind of like hopefully land back in that zone today if we get through all the stuff I wanted to kind of talk about. So today we're going to talk about first, actually, a very core classical optimal control topic that we've really glossed over so far in the class, which maybe, I don't know, I've traditionally done that in this class last few years because it's sort of aimed at like more computer science-y people who maybe didn't do lots of ODEs in their past lives, but we'll give it a try today and hopefully it's not that painful. So calculus of variations, which is classically, like historically, the language actually of optimal control theory. So it's basically how you optimize with respect to functions rather than vectors. And in this context, when we say function, really we're talking about optimizing with respect to a trajectory that's a function of time, like a continuous trajectory. So basically how you do all the stuff we've been doing in continuous time without discretizing first. Cool. So we'll do that, a little bit of that. And then like basically, I think one way of summing up the whole thing here is how to basically look at physics as trajectory optimization or optimal control. So if who in here took like a, I don't know, like grad level like physics class of some kind, like saw like Hamilton's principle, Euler-Lagrange stuff? Okay, nobody basically, maybe like one or two people. Okay, well, this will be fun then. And then yeah, kind of like all the connections between like these weird words you've maybe heard before, like a bunch of famous mathematicians. So like kind of Lagrange and Hamilton, like and then Pontryagin, which we have seen in here before, right? The maximum or minimum principle. Basically, these are all like almost the same thing. And in some sense, the Pontryagin thing is like the most general one of them. And like the Lagrange viewpoint and the Hamilton viewpoint are like kind of special cases of the Pontryagin thing that we've talked about in optimal control. And also, by the way, hopefully today I'll like explain to you what the Hamiltonian thing is all about and why that's a thing. And you know, before I just like dropped it on you at the beginning of the class, like months ago, is like, and we're just going to make up this weird function called the Hamiltonian and write this weird Pontryagin thing down. So hopefully I'll clear some of that up today, like what that actually is and stuff. All right, so any questions about any of this stuff? right, here we go. So first thing to talk about is kind of like this idea of like infinite dimensional optimization or like vectors or whatever. So the idea here really behind this like whole calculus of variations thing is we're gonna try to reason directly in like the space of trajectories. And we're gonna think about those as infinite dimensional vectors. And in the following sense, it's not as weird as it might sound at first. It's like not too bad. So basically, if we imagine like we've been doing in here, like we have like samples in time kind of trajectories. So we have a bunch of sample points. So if we kind of look at that, so we're going to sample trajectory x of t. And for this discussion, we'll just assume it's on the interval like from t equals 0 to t equals 1, just to be simple. So we've got, you know, this kind of thing. There's t, there's x, and, you know, it's something that's like wiggling around, whatever. And we've got a whole bunch of sample points in here. So this is like t equals 0 down here. This is, say, t equals 1 over here. And maybe we're sampling at like 10 hertz or something. And you've got all your little knot points like this. So maybe this is like, you know, t1. T2, blah, blah, blah. Cool. And so if we were to take all these sample points at, you know, these TKs and stack them up into one big vector, we'd have this kind of thing. Say up to xn, where we have n samples. And like the idea here is that, you know, this is kind of the setting we've been working in. We've written everything down like this, you know, when we've done collocation and stuff, we have all these sample points at discrete times. So literally all we're talking about here is kind of taking the limit as like n goes to infinity here. So it's the same, you know, t naught, t final. And, you know, think about it as limit. You go from, say, 10 hertz to 100 hertz to 1,000 hertz to like infinite hertz sampling, right? And so in the limit of like ultra fine sampling here, that big x vector there is going to become an infinite dimensional vector, right? And that's basically in the limit as the sampling, you know, frequency goes to infinity, you recover the continuous function x of t on the interval. So that's kind of what we're talking about. So, you know, most of the time, just think about like these things as vectors, and that's kind of cool and mostly works out. And, you know, the mathematicians would maybe not like this so much, but I'm pretty fast and loose with the math. And like this works out in all reasonable cases. Okay, so now what we're gonna talk about. So we already know how to do like basic, you know, calculus and take gradients of functions of vectors like this. What we're gonna talk about now is like, you know, kind of like maybe stretch your definition of a gradient a tiny bit. And to talk about how we like kind of handle this limiting case and differentiate a function of a function with respect to a function. So let's do that. Differentiating with respect to functions. And maybe every time I say function in this context, just think trajectory, right? It's like x of t, it's a function of time. And it's just think about it as like a vector, but like having taken this infinite sampling frequency limit. Okay, so given some function, let's call it f of x, which would be like our cost function that we usually kind of think about. So this is from like, say, Rn to R. So it's eating that trajectory thing and spitting out a scalar. And for now, to make this concrete, let's think about, you know, our favorite quadratic cost function. And in here specifically, I'm also going to do like, I'm going to stick a 1 over n in front. So that this thing is consistent as I take the limit. Okay, so think about this. And like we all know, you know, the derivative here, if I take the gradient of this thing, like one way of thinking about it is the best linear approximation? To the function. And we're going to like try to generalize our usual way of thinking about this stuff a little bit. I'm going to like kind of be very pedantic for a second, and I'm going to write this thing out. So like, that's what we're after, this, you know, x plus delta x thing. I'm just going to like write, plug that into our example function here and like expand this out. And, you know, if I oil that thing, it's exactly, you know, this sort of thing. And kind of with this best linear approximation thing in mind, if I stare at this thing, basically what I'm going to do is get rid of any nonlinear terms. So that's constant, fine. This is linear, this is linear, this is quadratic. I'm going to ditch the quadratic term and just keep everything else. So we'll get rid of that and then write this down, you know, this approximate thing. It's 1 over n x transpose x plus 1 over n x transpose delta x plus delta x transpose x. And so, you know, this thing over here is, of course, the original function. And then this thing over here, this whole thing is, you know, like usually we're used to thinking about a gradient as like some vector or something. We're going to kind of try to stretch our imagination a little bit here and think about this now as some, basically as a function that eats a delta x and spits out a delta f, and it's linear in delta x, but it doesn't have to be a vector, right? So you can think about it like this. Cool. Okay, so yeah, it's a thing that's linear in the argument that you can plug a delta x into and get a delta f out of. So we can like the, and then kind of the bridge to like this infinite dimensional weird thing, we're going to write this out in components. So I wrote this out like, you know, x transpose x, which we're used to doing. I can equivalently write out that function as a sum over the components. And so this would be, you know, f of x is sum, say, over k from 1 to n, like xk squared, right? And if I go and plug in my x plus delta x thing here, I can put this in the, oh yeah, I've got the 1 over n out here too. I can write this guy as, you know, xk plus delta xk squared. I can do the exact same thing that we were doing before and get something like xk squared plus, if I like, you know, expand that guy out, I mean, yeah, not complicated. We're just going to be a little sort of and then I can make the same move and say, I want to get rid of this and then get like the best linear approximation. And I'm going to get kind of this sort of thing. Okay. And then same deal, like this, you know, right, we've got the original thing. And now this guy, we're going to think of this as like a big function thing that eats delta x's and spits out delta f's. Okay, so now that I wrote this out in components, right, it should be kind of obvious what's going to happen. What I basically want to do now is like take that limit as the sampling frequency goes to infinity. What's going to happen to these? So I can do that nicely in this form. So what's going to happen if I take the limit as n goes to infinity here? And I remember like freshman calculus, what does this look like? Yeah, if this is the Riemann sum, right? So this is like your high school calculus, you know, definitions of integrals. Like if I take that n goes to infinity limit, x becomes x of t, this becomes an integral, you know, from t equals zero to t equals one of this like continuous function now. Okay, so let's do that. So I'm going to write this, the continuous versions, we'll use capital F, and I'll be a little bit pedantic about the notation. So it's clear. So we're talking about t equals 0 to 1. This just looks like x of t squared dt. And we're going to do the exact same sort of Taylor expansion-y thing. So I've got x of t, and then I'm going to plug in now a delta x. And now the delta x is also a function of time. So delta x of t. And we're going to like go ahead and plug everything in here. And there shouldn't be any real surprises about any of this. So it's x of t plus delta x of t squared dt. Then I can like, you know, do sort of normal things here. And I'm going to get like x of t squared plus, say, 2x delta x plus delta x squared. And then I'm going to say, oh, I don't want the quadratic term. And I'm going to get a thing that looks like this. And now I'm kind of back in the same, you know, situation. So this guy is my original f of x of t. And this guy is my, basically my like, you know, gradient function. And is it, hopefully it's a little bit clear now why I belabored this point about it being a gradient function. Like essentially in this case, like if I were just dealing with vectors, right? Like I could kind of like divide through by delta x and make this thing look like, you know, the sort of like gradient-y thing we're used to dealing with. But here I kind of, because this is all buried inside the integrals, I can't really divide out the delta x anymore. So we're going to keep it in there and think of it like this gradient function thing where I have to plug the delta x in to evaluate this integral, and that's my gradient, right? That whole thing is kind of my gradient operator, if you like. So that's kind of, you know, hopefully that made some sense, and we kind of walked through step by step, like kind of the progression from like normal matrix vector calculus stuff that we've been doing a lot of, like through to like writing out components, like the connection between that. If you take the limit, that turns into the integral. And then here's the integral version. Cool. And then the last thing to say is there's kind of, I used sort of notation closer to what we're used to in here, but in there is like kind of more standard notation in the calculus of variations that looks a little different. And so I'll show you that real quick. So the way this would be written like classically in the field is with this funky delta. So you would say, and that the way you say that out loud is variation. So this says like the variation of F is this guy. And then the delta X, which is a trajectory, right? Or a function of time, you write that as like this kind of funky delta, and you say variation of X. So this is. And then this guy is. X. And the main thing to say about this, and like the main kind of notational thing, is that in this context, right, like normally with like scalars or vectors or whatever, we're used to kind of like effectively dividing by the delta x, bring it over the other side and writing something like delta f over delta x equals thing. Here you can't really do it because it's buried inside the integral, so we're going to just leave it like this. Makes sense? So, and you're going to think of that whole integral thing as like your, it's basically like your gradient times your delta x that we're used to seeing for like matrices and vectors and stuff. So we don't really, it's not really common to do this sort of thing. We kind of leave it there. Cool. Any questions about this? Okay. So this is like the basic, what is an infinite dimensional vector thing? What does it mean to take a gradient with respect to a infinite dimensional vector or trajectory or function or whatever? This is kind of the recipe. And you can think about it like really straightforwardly as just like the continuum limit of some like, you know, sampled like in time vector like we're used to doing. Okay, cool. So that's the basic, that's what we mean by variational calculus, calculus of variations. That's what the variation word means. It's the delta on the trajectory. Cool. Okay, so now that we got that out of the way, we can talk about kind of the next step, which is like essentially to do optimization. Like this is what we need. We need to be able to like, if we want to minimize our F here, we basically want to be able to compute this gradient thing and then set it equal to zero. And that's basically like classical optimal control. That's what you do. You think about it at this level in continuous time. So what we're going to do now is kind of take a little tour through the least action principle where we're going to do this. And this, historically, this is where this stuff kind of came from. This is like classical physics, how you get like dynamics. This is how you get the manipulator equation, the Lagrange equations, blah, 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 that stuff. And this predates all the control stuff. The control stuff wasn't done like Pontryagin, that's all 20th century. That's actually 1950s and on. So that's a way more recent, you know, less than 100 years. But this least action stuff goes back a couple hundred years to like the 1700s, 1780s, I think. So this is kind of where this stuff was originally figured out. And the basic idea is you want to basically like most of physics you can formulate as optimization. And this has a long history. And what I'm going to show you is basically how to turn all of physics essentially into trajectory optimization. It's all trajectory optimization. All this classical physics stuff is all, they're all trajectory optimization problems, and show you like how that's all connected. Okay, so like for rigid body systems, multi-body systems, robots, essentially, we've all seen like the manipulator equations, right? So I'll show you like where that kind of comes from real quick. So basically for like a rigid body system, like our robots that we're used to. We can like get the dynamics or simulate the system, say, by like minimizing the following problem. And it won't be, I'm going to throw this out there. There's like lots of intuition and like kind of details on like, you know, explanatory kind of things we can talk about here, but I'm going to write it first. So we've got this function, which we're going to call big S. Again, it's a cost function. It's a function of our pose trajectory, which we're going to write as Q of T. And it's this integral thing. It's minimizing the difference between the kinetic energy and I'll explain what all this stuff is real quick, a sec. Difference between kinetic and potential energy. And this is like our cost function along this trajectory. So let me write in some of this stuff. So actually put this down a little bit. So let's see, this is the pose trajectory. This S thing is called the action. This thing, right, this is 1/2 mv squared, right? So this is the kinetic energy. And then this thing is the potential energy, which, you know, for like gravity, it's basically, you know, well, around the surface of the earth, it's basically some like, you know, the dot, like G transpose, you know, Z, it's the, you know, G times mg times your height. If it's a spring, it's 1/2 kx squared, right? That kind of thing. So if I plug those energies in for my given system and just minimize this thing, I get the trajectory that the system will follow. That's kind of cool. So we're going to now, any questions about this first? Who's seen this before? Okay, maybe kind of sort of a few of you. Okay, so and what did you do with this when you saw this thing in like your previous classes or whatever?
I think we were making dynamics equations with it.
Yeah, exactly. So the classic way you see this in like a dynamics class is somebody writes this down once and then they do this weird calculus of variations, integration by parts, voodoo, and then like you get the Euler Lagrange equations and then you never touch this again. So I'm going to try to like connect some dots for you with this thing, the stuff we've done. Okay, so just to keep our lives simple for right now, in general, right, for like some generalized coordinates or whatever, that mass matrix thing in there, actually, maybe I should write that in. This is the mass matrix. Is a function of your q's, right? It's a function of configuration. It varies. We're just going to, for simplicity right now, assume it's fixed. It's just a lot of notational baggage otherwise, but it's not a big deal to do it. Okay, and now the move we're going to make, which is not standard and probably not something you've seen before, if you've seen this before, is we're going to like explicit. So right here, everything's in terms of q, right? And we've got q dots in there for the velocities. We're going to explicitly now introduce a velocity variable. So now what I'm going to get is this optimization problem. So I'm minimizing with respect to the q trajectory and the v trajectory. I've got this action thing that's a function of the q trajectory and the v trajectory. And this is equal to integral from t naught to t final, 1/2 mv squared, basically. And then we've got our potential energy, which is just a function of position, right? Okay, so we've got this. And then we're now, because we introduced the v, we have a constraint that we didn't have before. So this is subject to the constraint that q dot has to equal v. By the way, you don't always need it to be strictly q dot equals v. In fact, there's lots of cases where q dot is not v. There's one very obvious one that we talked about in the class a whole bunch. Anyone have a idea what that might be? Where your velocities are different from the derivatives of your like pose variables. Exactly. So when you rigid body, so if you have a single rigid body, usually we write that down with a quaternion or a rotation matrix, and then you want your angular velocity in there, your omega, right? So there, this equation is not just that, right? It's got some extra math in there to map omega into q dot for the quaternion or the rotation matrix, right? So lots of situations where it's not this. And that's not a big deal here. You can totally handle that. We're going to make things easy for now, just so you know, though. Okay, so here's the punchline. Once I've done this, if I stare at this for a sec and like think about changing some letters around, in particular, if I sort of like squint and, you know, imagine that Q's an X and that V's a U, what does this look like? This is exactly a standard form trajectory optimization problem, where the controls are the velocities and the states are the pose. And the dynamics, right? If I switch right up, this is x dot input u. So this is a single integrator. If you had more complicated, you know, like angular velocity quaternion stuff, then this would be something more complicated. It would be some general like f of x u, right? But here it's trivial integrator dynamics. So that's kind of the cool thing. And just to make it super clear what we're talking about, we've got x equals q, u equals v, and then your dynamics, right, x dot equals f of x, u is just u, right? And so like I can write, and some particular choice of cost function, right? So I could write this down like, you know, the way we've typically done it. I can just change, you know, literally just change the letters around. Change S to J, right? We've used J for cost function for the control stuff. Function of X and U, blah, blah, blah. And it's just, you know, T naught to T final, stage cost. And then, you know, dynamics constraint. So does everyone see that? It's like 100% an optimal control problem. Like nothing weird. That's it. Okay. So now, like, let's go ahead and like actually think, any questions about this first before I... Cool. So optimal control. So the connections are clear and like physics equals optimal control. That's kind of fun. So now we're going to do, which, you know, maybe we should have done very early in the class, is let's go solve this thing using calculus of variations, which gets you, if I do this, if I set this gradient equal to zero, what I get out is the Pontryagin minimum principle. So we kind of did it in discrete time early in the class. Now we're going to do it in continuous time, the classical way, more or less, with calculus of variations. So let's do that. And if I do it, you know, in terms of X's and U's like this, we call it Pontryagin minimum principle. I'm going to do it in terms of Q's and V's in the physics version. Just, it's a little simpler because we have a specific functional form there to work with. That's the same thing. So let's go ahead and do that. Maybe I'll start a new page for that. So we're going to set gradients with respect to V and Q equal to zero to find a minimum of this guy. So if I do the stuff we've been doing, I'm going to first plug in, I'll first do it on the V's. So we need it to be true for everything, right? I have to set the gradients of all things equal to zero. So I'll do the V gradient first, set that equal to zero. Then I'll do the Q gradient, set that equal to zero. And we'll get a few different conditions. So I'll write this one out first. I'm going to do exactly the stuff we've been doing. So we're going to plug in V plus delta V, and I'll leave off the function of T stuff, the extra notation. Hopefully that's clear now. Potential term, no big deal. And then I'm going to also put the dynamics constraint. So this guy, U dot equals V, I'm going to put that in with a Lagrange multiplier on it. So we're going to write lambda transpose times Q dot minus V in there. Cool. So this is going to look like this, and I've got the Q dot, and then the V, I'm going to just plug in my delta V as well. Okay, DT. So now we're going to do like the stuff we've been doing, and kind of like massage this around a tiny bit to get it to just be linear in the delta Vs. So I've got the variation of S equals, and if I kind of, you know, do a little rearranging, it's not too much of a stretch to kind of see what's going to happen. You get something like this. So I need this thing to be zero. I'll do one more sort of step. So I can write this as mv minus lambda times delta v t equals zero. And so remember, think of this entire thing like your like gradient function. That's a function of delta V. And the trick here, like usually we set the gradient equal to zero and that's kind of the whole thing. It's a little bit subtle here, but not, it's the same argument basically. What we need here is for this thing to equal zero for all possible delta Vs. Which is the same thing as saying the gradient has to equal zero, right? It's like that the delta V is arbitrary here. So if I say that, what it's really saying, for that to hold up for any arbitrary delta V that I could plug in here, this guy has to be zero for all time. So that's kind of the key leap. It's just saying gradient equals zero, though. It's the same thing we're used to. So then we get the following thing, mv minus lambda equals zero. Put a box around that, save it for later. So what's my lambda here? What's the Lagrange, like, what's the physical interpretation of the Lagrange multiplier for this thing? What's MV? Momentum. Yeah, so the multipliers here are the momentum. So there's some connection between like momentum and like cost to go gradients. Remember, that was what it was for the optimal control problem. Keep that in the back of your head for a sec. Okay, so now we'll do it for the Qs. So Q plus delta Q. And now we're just going to go and plug this in the way we've been doing. So now the V stuff, we don't do anything. We've got potential. And then we have the constraint term. And there's a little bit of a funky thing right here that we got to talk about. So this is fine. I can sort of like, basically what I'm gonna do now is Taylor expand this down to first order. So I have the linear and delta Q thing. So I got variation of S is minus dV dQ times delta Q plus lambda transpose delta Q dot. So here's where it gets a little funky, and maybe some of you have seen this before. So basically what I want to do here is what I did up here. I want to like factor this so it's the delta multiplying some other thing. So I want to do that here. I basically want to pull delta Q out, have it multiplying by something else, right? The problem is this is delta Q dot. So I can't like cleanly pull this over. So this is like the classic trick in calculus of variations is to like, essentially what I want to do is make this a delta Q, not a delta Q dot. So I can do that. The trick here is integration by parts. Who remembers what this is? It's like freshman calculus stuff that you never remember. So I'll tell you what the trick is, and then like you can derive this. It's literally just the product rule backwards. But what it basically, the result is you can flip the dot and pick up a minus sign. That's the rule. How you get that is I'll like, maybe we'll plug it in here as a little aside. So if I have like d dt of like x times y, this is equal to x dot y plus x y dot, right? We all know that. So what I'm going to do is like, if I just put integrals on both sides, I get like x, y, evaluated it, you know, at the endpoints is integral x dot y dt plus integral x, y dot dt. And so the trick is like, if I want to flip, if I want to move the dot, right? So I have, let's say, so in this case, I have the dot here. I want the dot on the first one. So I'm basically going to just move this over. I get minus this guy. I get this kind of term that goes away. It turns out that flipped the dot, right? For picking up a minus sign. So that's the trick. That's how you do it. So we're going to do it. And we're going to get minus lambda dot transpose delta Q at the end of the day. So I flip the dot, pick up a minus sign. Hopefully that's clear from that, how you do that. Okay, so that's the trick. And now we can do the thing we wanted to do. So we can write this as minus grad V of Q plus lambda dot all transpose times delta Q. Should be maybe an extra code. Remember, lambda here is also a trajectory, function of time, whatever. Okay, so this whole thing needs to be zero. We're going to make the exact same argument as before. Has to be true. for all possible delta Qs. So what we're going to be left with then is grad V plus lambda dot equals zero. Box for that guy. Okay. So that's taking like the derivative with respect to Q, derivative with respect to V, setting equal to zero. I get these two conditions. First one, second one. And then last one that we're, you know, we always get is I take the derivative with respect to lambda and I just get the original constraint back. So we get three sort of sets of equations. So if I put that all together, I get the following three things. I got lambda equals mv. I got lambda dot equals minus grad v. And I've got q dot equals v. Okay, so these three equations all together, like so, this is Pontryagin's minimum principle for this particular optimal control problem. This is the classic old school continuous time calculus variations way of getting at it. And so some quick, let's write that down. And like we said already, the Lagrange multiplier here is momentum, which in physics usually you write down as little p. Okay, so couple fun things that maybe will connect this back. So this is weird and non-standard. This thing I just showed you is basically in no textbooks. It's a very weird, it's basically me rewriting physics as optimal control, and then like the physics equations turn out to be Pontryagin for this particular choice of cost function and dynamics constraint, right? But this is super nice and super general. It's actually, I would argue this is a better way to do it than most people do it, because this also includes situations where Q dot doesn't equal V, like rigid body dynamics, if you want to have other things in the state vector in a very clean, nice way. Okay, so a couple things to connect this back to stuff you've probably seen before or is like a little bit more familiar. If I take those equations, first of all, let's interpret those real quick. So lambda, it's very clear that this is the momentum, right? So what's lambda dot? What's the derivative of momentum?
Force.
Force. So what's this thing?
Something between
this. This is literally F equals ma, right? So this is lambda dot, that's derivative of momentum. Momentum's mv. So if m's constant, that's ma. So this is ma, and then this minus grad v, this is F, right? If you have a conservative force, minus grad of the potential is the force. So this is literally F equals ma. So this is telling you what the momentum is. This is telling you this is F. This is literally F equals ma, and then this is your kinematics for your system. Cool. Okay, so let's do some stuff to connect this back to like more familiar territory. So if I take those three equations, in some sense, those are kind of redundant, right? Like there's some easy stuff. So I can eliminate some variables. So if we go ahead and eliminate V and lambda from those equations, we get the Euler-Lagrange equations that you've probably seen before, aka manipulator equation in robotics. So this, right, if I go ahead and so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take Q dot equals V, plug that into the first equation. So I'll get MQ dot equals lambda. And then I'm going to take that and plug it into the second equation. And if I do that, I'm going to get MQ double dot equals minus grad V. So that's literally F equals MA now, right? Super clear. And that's what you would get if you wrote down the Euler-Lagrange equations, right? The classic stuff. It's also the manipulator equation, right? And you know, think of a lot. And this would be your G in manipulator lingo. Okay, so that's cool. That's if we get rid of V and lambda, which is how you usually write down the least action thing. That's how we started, basically, right? So if we go all the way back to where we started up here, If I had left this alone, I guess the very first version of this, and never introduced the V variable or the constraint, right? If I just stayed here and did everything here, I would have landed at this point, right? Okay, so then the next trick we can play is if instead, if we eliminate the V, but keep the lambda, we get Hamilton's equations, or the Hamiltonian form of the dynamics. And this is super easy to see also, right? So basically all I'm gonna do is take the Q dot equals V thing and plug that in to the previous two equations to get rid of the Vs. So then I'll get lambda equals M Q dot, and lambda dot equals minus grad 2. Cool. So maybe I'll put some boxes on this guy. And so if I call lambda p there, which is the usual physics notation, this is exactly Hamilton's equations. So the one next trick then, so like this is kind of, you know, Hamilton, we've heard Hamiltonian before here with the original like Pontryagin stuff. Maybe you've also heard it in a physics context. So what's going on with that Hamiltonian thing? It's not shown up here yet. So what we're going to do to like figure that out and land on that result is we're going to take this substitution where we eliminated the V, and we're going to go plug it back into the original integral stuff up here. So I'm going to eliminate, basically I'm going to plug in V equals M inverse lambda. Right, so I'm going to write V in terms of lambda and plug it in everywhere that in there. So I'm going to totally get rid of V, but I'm going to keep Q and lambda. Cool. So let's go ahead and do that. So we're going to plug in V equals M inverse lambda, right? So that's just coming from over here, right? I have lambda equals MV. I'm just going to invert M and solve it the other way. For V is a function of lambda. We're just going to go plug that in. So if I go and write this out, what I want now is we're going to have like, this action thing is going to be the following. So I'm going to plug this into 1/2 mv squared. I'm going to get lambda transpose m inverse lambda. The potential thing doesn't change at all. And then the Lagrange multiplier term, I'm going to plug it in there as well, and we get lambda transpose q dot. Okay, so that's just me plugging the definition back in. Right. And this is the Hamiltonian now. So literally, if I, oh, did I run? I messed them up. They got a minus sign there. Cool. Okay. So this thing inside the integral now is what we call the Hamiltonian. So we can rewrite this whole thing as, min over q of t lambda of t of this guy. Hamiltonian, which is function of q and lambda of t. Cool. So that's, I don't know, that's what where it comes from. It basically, you're like, you know, eliminating the velocities and just using these lambdas as the like, variables instead. And the like physics version of this is instead of, you know, position velocity, I'm using position and momentum. Who cares, right? It's like an equivalent thing. It doesn't matter. From an optimization perspective, we would call this the dual form of this like problem, right? So you got the primal form where it's like Qs and Q dots. That's the Lagrangian thing. The dual form where it's like basically I'm eliminating some variables and like rewriting the problem in terms of the multipliers. That would be called the dual form of the problem in like classical kind of optimization context, is this Hamiltonian thing. And then like this like Pontryagin version where I've got everything in there, you might call that like the primal dual sort of form where it's got all the variables. Cool. So these are all just kind of like special cases of each other.
Problem. The dual, we still have Q.
We still have Q. It's really about, it's sort of the velocity variables are really what we're talking about.
Why is that funny? I select a difference than we discussed in the PMP. When we introduced the Hamiltonian in the first place, it looked like it's L plus lambda transpose times F.
Yeah.
Here, it's very different.
It doesn't. It's exactly the same. If you actually think about what the definition of L is here and what the definition of the dynamics is, it's exactly the same. So remember, what's our F here?
This V.
Yeah, so it turns out this is basically what the F turns into. And this is your cost function, right? L.
The
one-step cost.
Wow.
So they're exactly the same. If you actually go plug in the definitions, like I wrote out up here, like this kind of, yeah.
Here, the Lagrangian.
Yeah.
Is this Lagrangian?
Yeah, so this L here, the little L that I wrote down, what we would call the stage cost in the optimal control problem. In this guy, it's the Lagrangian. It's what in physics you call the Lagrangian. I didn't sort of do that here because it's a little confusing because like they're slightly different. Basically, in physics, the Lagrangian is the stage cost. In optimization, the Lagrangian is like cost plus Lagrange multiplier term, right? So the definitions in physics and optimization vary a little bit. So I didn't call it Lagrangian, but yes, this little L, which we would call the stage cost in optimization and optimal control, in physics, this is the Lagrangian, the physics Lagrangian, not... Yes, the Lagrangian of Euler-Lagrange equations is the stage cost here in the optimal control viewpoint.
That's very interesting.
This is kind of like super weird, crazy stuff. So I don't know.
Yeah.
This is weird stuff that I'm kind of into. What I'm giving you right now is fairly off the beaten path stuff.
Why we introduce this is to see like underlying optimization structure actually the same.
Yeah, I'm basically like all this stuff is the same. Like Pontryagin in some sense is the most general version of these, but literally all these things are just setting the gradient equal to zero for some optimization problem. And they're just like slightly reworked variations on the problem, right? So if I like write the problem down like this, where it's just a Q of T thing, and I set the gradient with respect to Q of T equal to zero, I get Euler-Lagrange equations. If I introduce velocities and this constraint of the Lagrange multiplier and do the same thing, set the gradients equal to zero, I get Pontryagin. If I rewrite it with, you know, like the Hamiltonian thing, like if I eliminate the V's and just have lambdas and Q's and I do the same thing, then I get Hamiltonian. And they're all the same thing. They're just slightly different. They're basically just changes of variables, like which variables you're choosing to use to write the problem down.
One side we have PMP and another side we have a lot of different functions, like the Euler.
Basically, the Euler-Lagrange and Hamilton things are special cases of Pontryagin. Okay. They're just like if I write down Pontryagin and then do some variable elimination or whatever, I get the other ones.
So this is like the physical simulation in the framework of the.
Yeah, and there's kind of a fun punchline on that too that I think we can do. I think we have time. So yeah, this is weird stuff. Hopefully, this is making some sense and like is interesting to you. But I'll tell you why I'm into this and why like I think this is cool, and maybe one of the best things I've ever come up with. Is like you can now take, so like now that we have this perspective, cool. Like physics is optimal control. Like this formulation right here, it's exactly an optimal control problem. I can solve it. Like the classical like manipulator stuff is equivalent to Pontryagin. It is this trajectory optimization problem up here, right? Whatever, this guy. It's exactly a trajectory optimization problem with a particular cost function, which is the Lagrangian, and a particular dynamics constraint, which is just like the kinematics there, right? And the Vs are the controls and the states are the poses, whatever. So cool. So now that we can do that, the cool thing now that's like actually very like useful and interesting from a robotics perspective, this is all very researchy and slightly nuts, is that I can basically use numerical optimization tools that we have from like this class to simulate dynamics. Why might I want to do that? That is like the, it's, I mean, this is kind of very academic until you're like, why might I care? Here's why you might care. Has anyone tried simulating contact dynamics before, or used a simulator that like did contact dynamics with like impacts and friction? Yeah. So what simulators have you tried? Ooh, like Simscape or some?
Just simulating like super simple contacts, all of it.
Yeah. So anybody else? Ujoko, Isaac. Yeah. So these things are, yeah. Anybody else? Anything else? There's gazebo, bullet. Yeah. So there's all kinds of these things. Basically, this like contact dynamics thing is like one of the core challenges in robotics. And it's super nasty. And it turns out this perspective is extremely useful for this. So I will now explain that part. So basically, impacts and friction are non-smooth. And this is very annoying and kind of terrible and causes all kinds of problems with gradient evaluations. And strictly speaking, right, if I slam into the table, if I drop a brick and it slams into the floor, like what happens when it hits the ground? So what happens to the velocities when it hits the ground? Let's say inelastic collision. It doesn't bounce. Inelastic means it does this. Yeah, so what happens? So if I go epsilon before it hits the ground, it's got some velocity, some negative velocity, and then epsilon after it hits the ground, the vertical component of the velocity is zeroed out. It goes from something, some non-zero value to zero in the rigid body, you know, limit instantaneously. So you've got like a jump discontinuity in your velocity, right? So then what is the acceleration at that time, at the impact time? It's some weird like delta function, right? It's like an impel. It's like this giant infinite spike thing. So how do I even write down F equals MA there? Think about that for a second. If I'm trying to simulate this with like, you know, standard, you know, F equals MA stuff, think point mass, like the simplest possible setting. I can't even actually write down the acceleration at the impact time. It's some, like the acceleration is instantaneously infinite if I'm taking like seriously this rigid body inelastic collision stuff, right? Obviously in real life, everything deforms a little bit and like that impact time is actually finite, but it's really short. But if you take this kind of stuff seriously, when you're trying to write down your dynamics, like F equals MA isn't even legit. You can't even really do that, right? Like you have infinite forces over some super tiny time. The integral of that thing is well-defined, right? The integral is the total change in momentum. But like that instantaneous thing is like ill-defined mathematically. And so sort of like basically the message here is like it's super nasty, it does weird stuff, and all these simulators are making a ton of approximations to try to get at this. There's all kinds of smoothing approximations, like I don't know, lots of different ways to do it. And this is part of the like sim to real gap that everybody talks about, is all the approximations that these simulators make around contact interactions. Yeah.
Address that, because can't you just say directly like as soon as we hit the ground then we're at zero?
Yeah, so you can, so that's called the like hybrid modeling approach, where you explicitly model like continuous phases and then discontinuous like jumps in the dynamics. That's a completely like reasonable way to go, and that stuff's very common in locomotion, where you can explicitly write down those maps, right, and like think about a handful of footstep transitions. But what happens if I've got like some in-hand manipulation thing? What happens if I'm like rolling a ball around in a, you know, in a hand? What do you do there? You basically end up like, you know, in that context, you have like continuous contacts. It blows up on you. So like the message there is like, if you have a handful of point contacts, like if you're just talking about walking, like for a quadruped on point feet, there's only 4 points of contact. There's only a handful of modes, right, to write down. And like, you have to do that, right? You have these guard functions that you're checking all the time. Well, what happens if I have like a million contact, like even if I just scale up to like 100 contact points, how many possible contact modes are there for 100 contact points? Like it's all possible combinations drawn from those 100 points. It's 100 factorial. So that approach, it's cool if you have like a couple of feet, But if you're trying to do contact rich manipulation things, it blows up combinatorially. So you basically can't do it in sufficiently complicated scenarios. It only really works out in like pretty simple contexts. So basically none of the simulators like Mujoko, Bullet, Isaac do that because of this issue. If you're trying to like really reason about like a very like a complex cluttered environment or something, you just can't keep track of all the guards and stuff. Yeah.
Just curious, if you have multiple content points and you have your content points is larger than three, then the problem is overdetermined. So how can you just infinitely for configurations of the forces?
Yeah. So this is actually like a very straightforward optimization thing. Essentially, you have to like add something to the problem to regularize it, to like have a unique solution. So you're totally right. It doesn't have a unique, it's called static indeterminacy, right? And this does some weird things. In practice, what you do is you regularize and like find the like smallest two norm, you know, lambda vector or something.
So in this formulation, we'll have multiple solutions based on your optimization.
I mean, you pick a regularizer and then it makes the solution unique. That's how it works out in practice. And that's kind of what all these things do. Okay, so let me write down some stuff. So there's lots of ways to do this. I would say like many simulators use so-called soft contact models. Like Mujoko does this. That are basically approximating essentially, if you like, you know, there's lots of details. But basically what these are all doing is like approximating impact with some kind of like nonlinear spring damper kind of thing. So that you can write down like a force model and continuous time and like, you know, have F equals MA kind of work out and simulate this thing numerically. The big issue with this is like, if I want this to be more realistic, like if I'm, you know, if me here on this ground, like it's pretty much a rigid body thing, right? And in particular, my foot doesn't sink into the floor when I do this. If I write down one of these nonlinear spring damper kind of things, it by construction, like your foot's got to sink into the floor a little bit. Like it's a spring force, right? So you always have a little bit of inner penetration. There's all these artifacts and you get creep also. So like if you write these models down, you can't get stick slip behavior either. So if you put something on an inclined plane, it's always going to slide a little bit. It's always going to creep. You can't actually get sticking static friction. Try it sometimes in Mujoko if you're curious. Take a block and stick it on an inclined plane. It always does this. It can't actually get static friction to work. Okay, so whatever. But a straightforward way to do it the way we've been talking about is basically to write down like a constrained leaks action problem. So basically, like, you know, we've been doing the following thing. We've got like this Q and V, and we've got our so what I might do here is like, so the key idea is basically we're gonna do like I'm going to discretize time like we always do in our control problems and get something like this. So we're going to go back to like discrete land. And I might have, you know, this kind of thing. That's like approximating my integral. And then I've got my kinematic stuff. And then so that's what we've done already in discrete time. Cool. It's very obviously standard form optimal control problem, right? And then I can also, though, if I solve it this way numerically, I can add more constraints. So I can just go ahead and put in something like this. where this guy is called a sine distance function, and this phi function basically returns like the distance to the closest thing in the environment, so like the height above the floor, say. So literally, like what I'm doing here is basically like rewriting this dynamics optimal control problem. I'm like discretizing it and like going to basically go solve this with like collocation, like we know how to do. And if I'm doing that and I'm using a solver to solve it, I can put whatever kind of equality, inequality constraints I want. So this, you know, looks exactly like our standard optimal control problem. Here's your dynamics, awesome, or whatever. Now I just put in an inequality constraint saying you're not allowed to go through the floor. I just go solve that with that constraint in there. And you basically get impacts and like for free. And in particular, what will happen here is the Lagrange multiplier for this constraint is going to become your impact force or your normal force. Make sense? Okay, so let's write this down. So just do collocation on the least action stuff. And now you can add all the constraints you want. Super cool. Impacts are easy. And in particular here, right, if you solve this with a good solver, like you're going to satisfy the constraints exactly or, you know, to whatever tolerances you want. And that means you're not going to get any weird interpenetration artifacts or any of that crap. Like it says don't go through the floor. As long as the solver converges and returns a solution, it's not going to go through the floor like, ever, right? Okay, so that's impacts. You can also get Coulomb friction, like stick slip behavior out of this, which we've talked about a little bit in class, right? We talked about maximum dissipation, friction cone stuff a little bit. So that still works here. So this is called maximum dissipation, right? We've seen this before. In continuous time, it looks like minimize the time derivative of the kinetic energy. It's like energy dissipation with respect to the friction force subject to this friction cone constraint that says norm of the friction has to be less than or equal to some friction coefficient times the normal force. And that N in particular, right? The N here is the Lagrange multiplier of that constraint in the other problem, right? And so if I want to do friction and impact in my simulator at the same time, what do I do? Exactly. I'm going to do the dynamic game thing that we saw in the driving example. I'm going to write down the first order necessary conditions, the KKT conditions for both problems. They're going to be coupled, like the N here is the multiplier from this guy, and the B here, the friction force, is going to show up in that guy as a forcing term. So they're cross-coupled. Just like, you know, the stuff we saw in the driving example, I'm just going to stack them all up, write down KKT conditions for both problems, and then like jointly solve both at the same time with Newton's method, which works out fine. And in particular, right, if I'm doing simulation, the trick here too is like, you know, this, the length of the trajectory in here is arbitrary. So if I just care about doing simulation, I can make this one time step. I can just make it a single time step and I can solve all this over just a one time step trajectory. And that gets me a time stepping method that I can just like solve a tiny problem and go forward in time, right? Okay, so that's, yeah, let's write that down. Also, yeah, here I can obviously discretize this in time as well using the same stuff we've been doing. It's no big deal. And to account for both of these things. This is basically a Nash equilibrium like we saw last time. Okay, I think that ends the crazy tour of random math ideas for the day. This is a lot. So we talked about like weird, how classical physics is trajectory optimization, how Euler-Lagrange and Hamilton stuff is you know, our special cases of Pontryagin with like variable elimination. Physics is trajectory optimization. If I embrace that and do collocation stuff like we know how to do, I can throw extra inequality constraints into my physics, which lets me handle impacts and friction super nice. And if I do impacts and friction together, those are two separate but coupled optimization problems. If I solve them simultaneously, it's a Nash equilibrium dynamic game style thing, like we saw with autonomous driving and all this other weird crap. So it's all connected. And this kept me busy for about 5 years of my life. I have a bunch of papers on this stuff. This is the simulation story I just told you is in a few papers from our lab. We made a simulator a couple of years ago called Dojo that I don't know, some of you guys might have heard of. That's kind of the major deal. The other big deal about this is if you do it this way and you're clever about how you solve the optimization problems, you can also return nice gradients through all these things. So I can give you like the A and B matrices or whatever with all the contact dynamics in there in kind of a clean way. It's kind of cool. Yeah.
Have like state estimation work by putting a magnet in the feet of robot.
Yeah, that was a different paper.
Is that leverage any of this like handling contact like impulse?
It's definitely reasoning about the contact, but we actually didn't use this stuff in that paper. Okay. That was maybe a much simpler setup. Like there, what we were really just trying to get at was how to detect foot slip. And the way you do that is compare the body IMU mapped through the leg kinematics to the foot IMU. And like if you compare those things, it becomes extremely obvious if the foot's stuck to the ground or not.
Do you think this could be like theoretically used to try to handle like impulse from IMU?
Totally. Yeah. So we've used this to do control. We actually have like, so we have the simulator paper and then we basically used this as the dynamics model in an MPC controller. Okay. And we're able to do what we call contact implicit MPC. So that's super cool. We can talk about that if you want another time. But last thing I wanted to do, I did write some code last night. That's just kind of a fun thing because this is interesting to me and I, you know, whatever. So this is me doing LQR on I should have written this out. I do have it written out, but we're out of time. So whatever. This is solving a simple harmonic oscillator like spring mass system as LQR. It basically, right, the potential's quadratic and the kinetic energy is quadratic. So it's basically an LQR problem. And that's kind of fun. So you can like go through and do your standard LQR thing with Riccati, like we know. And then you get out like the thing you expect. So that's kind of weird and interesting. And then the really fun one is this is an example where I put all of this stuff together. I did like a falling brick with all of the nastiness that we just talked about. So there's that sine distance function. This is in 2D. And I do all the Lagrangian stuff. I'm using IPOP to solve this stacked up mess. And this is just with impacts. So you kind of see like, I just have the impact stuff. It basically hits the ground and keeps sliding. And then this is the normal force. You can see it like when it hits the ground, you get this big spike. And then after that, it's basically MG. Kind of cool. And then this is with the friction as well. So it looks similar. It's still solving. Give it a sec. This has maximum this is the Nash equilibrium idea. So it's got maximum dissipation, friction, and so this is the X component, like this is the Y component. So hits the ground here, where it hits the ground, it starts slowing down due to the friction. And then here's the normal force that looks basically the same, right? Big spike when you hit the ground and then MG. Here's the friction force. So it's zero friction when you're in the air. When you hit the ground, you have a big normal force. Friction's pretty big. Then it kind of settles down to like mu times N here, where N equals MG. And it sort of starts to slow down. I think that's kind of it. Who's this guy? That was lambda. And what is this guy? Oh, this is a weird thing that we shouldn't talk about. Yeah, that's an artifact of like how I wrote it down in IPOP to get IPOP to solve it. Anyway, I don't know. Fun stuff. I think that's it.